Based on doctor's standing order. So you can see that it's still not legalized in Thailand for someone who is not doctor to prescribe drugs, but we are not asking their provider to prescribe PrEP. We are asking them to dispense PrEP according to doctor's order. So that's the main PrEP delivery service model in Thailand. In sub-Saharan Africa, in Kenya and Zimbabwe, they have demonstrated that to deliver PrEP to women, having the service integrated as part of the family planning clinics is one way to go. In Brazil, they have demonstrated quite an impressive retention rate of people who use PrEP in the program through 12 months, also with very impressive adherence. And they have also confirmed that self-report as a way of measure at PrEP adherence is an okay way to go compared to other measurements, other adherence measurements. So it is a relief to know that, and then we can continue to use that in our routine PrEP programs. And then in Senegal, to deliver PrEP to female sex workers, it has been successful that this can be done through the Ministry of Health clinics. And one of the interesting data, not actually the model, but the data from the US, is how PrEP users who are young populations access PrEP, because we know that even in many countries in our region where PrEP has already been implemented, we are not doing very good in getting young populations into PrEP service, especially those who are younger than 19 or 20s, who we know that they are actually at much more higher risk of getting HIV infection. So what we can see from the US data here is that among those who were adolescent, the majority of them were females, which is in contrast to the older population, not old, but older population, older than 20 years population, where the majority are men, and mainly men who have sex with men, right? And those who are providers of PrEP to this young population are mainly pediatricians, not infectious disease doctors. So they are pediatricians, they are emergency medicine physicians, they are a family medicine physician. So again, calling for an action to move PrEP away from the hands of infectious disease doctors. And then a bit about sexual health concerns when we are now rolling out or expanding PrEP services. We have seen in cities where PrEP use has been more matured that the STI incidence may be increasing at a significant level or a non-significant level. However, data from Melbourne demonstrated to us that those who have STI incidence are those who actually already had STI at baseline. And data from the US demonstrated that once someone discontinued PrEP, STI incidence went down. So what does this mean to us? It means that these PrEP programs are doing the right thing, targeting the right group, right subgroups of populations where inconsistent condom use already happened at the beginning, and that the clients can be empowered to decide by themselves when they need PrEP and when they do not need PrEP. So once they decide they can discontinue PrEP, that's the time where their STI went down. But beyond this bacterial STI thing, syphilis, gonorrhea, chlamydia, the Netherlands information also started to show some increased risk in hepatitis C incidence among PrEP users to the level that is quite comparable to HIV positive population. So we may have to think more about our weak infrastructure for STI screening in our region here if we are going to roll out PrEP rapidly. the previous study in Paris, just to show to you that among those who choose by themselves to be taking daily PrEP or on-demand PrEP in Paris, we have not seen any seroconversion within a mean follow-up time of 7 months. So the calculated number of HIV infection averted is 85%, and they have seen a very low discontinuation rate of PrEP in this program. And the last slide is about the study in Thailand to address a concern around PrEP use in transgender women, because we have seen a very low uptake overall of PrEP among transgender women, as well as low retention rate among transgender women who use PrEP. So these together point to the need for data to confirm whether or not there is drug interaction between feminizing hormones and PrEP. And the Thai data demonstrated that when we did an intensive pharmacokinetic studies among 20 transgender women, measuring their hormone levels without PrEP and then with PrEP, and then measuring hormone levels with PrEP and then without PrEP, what we found is that PrEP has nothing to do with the hormone levels. PrEP has nothing to do with the hormone level. So that means that for transgender women taking PrEP, you don't have to worry about the feminizing effects that you are getting from your hormones, okay? However, hormones may do something with the tenofovir level. What we did in the study is that we only measure tenofovir level in blood. So we have seen 13% decrease in the tenofovir exposure in blood. But we don't know if this will happen in at the tissue level or not. And we don't know if this has any clinical significance in terms of PrEP efficacy for HIV prevention. So what is the practical message for this right now? Because we have seen another two data after the 2018 conference showing the same trend from the US data, is that we may have to think of transgender women and do counseling for PrEP adherence for transgender women in the same way that we do for cisgender women. Meaning that the adherence level that we need to meet may be higher than those for men who have sex with men, when we say that okay, 4 tablets per week may be enough for HIV prevention. Okay, so that's the last slide. So to summary, I think we now know that with early and frequent HIV testing, with immediate ART initiation and with PrEP, we can certainly innate. However, we must not limit ourselves to just conventional way of doing HIV testing and treatment, and we have to be open-minded enough in order to explore as many innovative ways of getting people into HIV testing and provide HIV testing as possible in order to reach as many subgroups of populations as possible. And I think that we can be reassured that meaningful engagement of key populations or communities in the design and the delivery of HIV services is very much likely the way to go in order to ending the HIV epidemics in any settings, not only in low resource setting, but in any settings. And then I think we need a courage to go with the same day ART concept, because I believe and I have seen that it has been used successfully to revolutionize ART service delivery that we have been practicing for 20 years now. And lastly, we have seen good examples from Brazil and Vietnam, that countries or governments' genuine and proactive actions have been demonstrated to successfully get us closer to full domestic funding, which is very important for sustainability of HIV program. Thank you very much.
Wow.
I'm happy to take any questions for now.
Ya, selanjutnya untuk sesi tanya jawab, silakan bisa langsung untuk bertanya langsung kepada dokter Rita ya. Ada yang mau bertanya? Ya,
saya. Satu,
dua.
Soal habis itu.
Oke, selamat siang. Nama saya Leli dari UNH. Saya suka berdiskusi juga dengan teman-teman yang bergerak di bidang HIV/AIDS terkait PrEP. Ada pendapat beberapa teman yang bilang di Indonesia sebaiknya jangan mulai PrEP dulu sebelum coverage ART kita tinggi, karena di Indonesia ART coverage-nya baru 15%. Karena nanti akan terjadi persaingan untuk budgeting, karena ART untuk treatment saja mungkin sudah sangat mahal, apalagi nanti untuk prevention gitu. Bagaimana menurut pendapat Anda? Terima kasih.
I think it is a very important questions that many people may choose not to think seriously about it and just make this assumption that just because of the cost and the existing funding, we probably should not think of PrEP right now. But I have to say that when I showed to you the number from Australia, number from San Francisco, the reduction in the number of new HIV cases is not only because of test and treat. These are big cities where they have already reached the 90-90-90 targets for a few years now, and they have seen a stable number of new HIV cases. And it's only when these cities started to implement the rapid rollout of PrEP that they started to see the dramatic decrease in HIV incidence. So I would say that it would not be wise, especially when ART coverage is still very low and you are allowing more HIV transmissions to happen every day, to wait until you are getting to that certain level of ART coverage before you are thinking of starting PrEP. But it's true that this means money. It means that we will have to work together, not only among like doctors, but also with communities, with the governments, with the pharmaceutical companies, to really get to the price that the country as a whole can negotiate with the companies to get the price down, both for ART and both for PrEP. We have seen that, for example, we have a regional PrEP meeting earlier this year in Bangkok. And in Bangkok, we are so proud. We have been so proud that, oh, we are getting this very cheap price of PrEP drug because we have our own generic government pharmaceutical organization to produce PrEP. However, we learned from Malaysia that at the same economic level, Malaysia actually gets the price at half, the cost of PrEP at half price as what Thailand is getting. So it's actually the how the countries take it seriously into negotiating the price, and I would say that for us the experience is that once you have the reasons for why people should come out for HIV testing, which is if you test negative you have PrEP to be offered as one of the prevention options. If you test positive, you can get immediate ART. That's when people will realize that there's reasons to come out for HIV testing. I hope that answers some part of your questions.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Terima kasih, sangat menarik dengan inovasi terkait SIM-DERT. Pertanyaan saya, how about the quality of counseling? Because ini di hari yang sama memberikan ERV. Yang kedua, how about the partners? Yang ketiga, how about the adherence? Ada nggak menunjukkan tingkat kepatuhan dan partner diajak testing dan quality counselingnya bagaimana terkait kepatuhan tersebut?
Is this for ART or for
same day?
For same day ART. Okay. Thank you. Yes. I have not shown the data on viral load suppression, but what we have seen so far is that at month 6, which is the time when our guidelines recommend the first viral load testing after ART initiation, we have seen more than 95% viral load suppression among those who retain in the program. And as I showed to you that the retention at month 3 and month 6 is above 90%, it's 92% and 91%. That means that among those who retain in the program until 6 months, they actually have a similar rate of viral suppression compared to the standard of care group.
So you're monitoring after 6 months?
Yes. What we did is that we have the person who we call the navigator. Right, and the navigator support the adherents during the first few weeks, help them transfer to their long-term ART facilities, but still continue to make sure that the services they are receiving at their new long-term ART site is going smoothly, that they really get viral load tested at month 6 as they should, etc. So they still keep contact with the clients, although with the less frequent follow-up with the clients as compared to the very initial phase of ART initiation.
Question?
Okay, terima kasih. Saya ingin menanyakan tentang someday initiation ART. Jadi, bagaimana dengan infeksi oportunistik yang mungkin ada pada pasien itu? Apakah diselesaikan secara bersamaan dengan pemberian ART-nya atau bagaimana itu? Kemudian bagaimana dengan pemberian cotrimoxazole-nya? Kemudian yang kedua, apa kombinasi ART yang digunakan di sana sehingga pasiennya mau untuk menggunakan same-day ART initiation? Terima kasih.
Thank you. Very good question. You must be a doctor.
Yeah.
Yes, I the second questions maybe but second question may be easier to answer. We are using our first line regimen, which is still efavirenz based regimen, so tenofovir FTC and efavirenz. And that really one of the concern when we initially think about implementing same day ART, because we have learned, actually we used the same protocol that San Francisco have been using, and they're using this tenofovir FTC and dolutegravir with later on switching to abacavir 3TC dolutegravir, which is a once daily combination pills once they have the HLA B5701 results coming back, and we were thinking that so that's dolutegravir, so people can tolerate that well, you don't have to really do much counseling, etc. Anyway, we decided that since we still don't have dolutegravir in the country, if we are going to do this efferent based same day ART, would that be feasible? And I think that what we try to set up the team in a way that we have a full-time navigator in the clinic is the way to try to address that common side effect that we know will happen within the first few months. That is the reason why we have to delay the referral of our clients out of the clinic until 2 or 2.5 months. In the San Francisco model, they refer people out to their long-term ART care within 5 days. Okay. Okay, for us, if we are referring someone who is still have this dizziness and nightmare from efferents within the first week to other doctors, or may have rash during the referral, we would be blamed for sure with starting people too early on ART, etc., etc. So we have to make sure that our clients are quite stable on their ART before we refer them out. But then, to come back to your first question about how we rule out opportunistic infections, how we rule out especially those infections which can cause serious eye risk, we know that the only two opportunistic infections that can result in mortalities or morbidities related to immune reconstitution, inflammatory syndrome, is tuberculosis and cryptococcal meningitis, right? So we really take a careful clinical decision when we identify someone and consider whether they can screen in for same-day ART or should be screened out from same-day ART. I already mentioned to you a bit earlier that we use symptom screening for TB first. So anyone with symptom screening will be referred for GeneXpert. Anyone without symptoms will still have chest x-ray. So everyone will have chest x-ray. So you will then have a combination of chest x-ray, symptom screening, plus minus GeneXpert result, which can come back within the same day or just the next day to rule out someone for tuberculosis. Cryptococcal meningitis, we just do physical examination. And the blood, the amount of blood that we draw for, as I mentioned to you, for HIV confirmatory tests, as well as all the baseline safety lab tests and CD4 count. If CD4 count come back 1 or 2 days later with an amount less than 100, we will then ask our lab to also perform crypto antigen testing. With these certain clients where we are not very sure if they have opportunistic infections, so they may have some certain symptoms or physical exam findings that point you to some serious OIs, we may give them the 2 week supply of ART, but ask them not yet to start ART. But once we have the results of these additional labs coming back, we then will ask them to start ART. So you can see that some of them start ART on the second or third day, and another like 8% will start within that during the day 4 to day 7, for example. Yeah. So by doing this, I'm trying to say that even if we aim for same day ART, it does not mean that we are forcing everyone to take ART on that same day, right? It's just our intention to try to speed up all the lab investigation and as well as to think more seriously which labs actually are needed before we start ART. So if this means that liver function test, creatinine test, we don't need that before starting ART. We can always change the regimen a few days later on. So for those who have abnormal lab results, we will have the navigator call the clients and then ask them to come back for regimen switching. We have not seen high-risk cases among 2,000 people that we have started ART so far. And the main reason for not being able to start ART on that exact same day is question about TB. That's the most common concern. So right now we are like trying to still further optimize our same day ART algorithms in a way that we probably should have a better TB screening algorithm than using the symptoms, which many people will like meet one of the TB symptoms criteria and then have to be screened out for the same day ART eligibility.
Masih ada waktu 5 menit, satu lagi mungkin sebelum kita sambung ke berikutnya. Ada? Oh, oke, okay. Dokter Pandit, silakan.
one more question.
Thank you. Very nice presentation. I would like to ask related to the evidence to friend from Tala experience. You know, one of our concerns in Indonesia is, but we are Asian. We are Indonesian is not really obeyed treatment. We have bad experience with antibiotic, for example. So I mean, Thailand is also, you know, have Asian culture, and people usually judge Asian different to Western in related to the drug culture, something like that. So do you have any experience on that?
Thank you for that question. for ART adherence in general, before I go to PrEP adherence, I think for ART adherence in general, the culture, both on the provider side and on the patient side or client side in Thailand, has been quite good. We have seen, like, international in data from the national program, a very high viral suppression rate. It's just that we need to encourage more viral testing. But among those who have viral tested, viral suppression rate is very high. So I think it's not that much concern in terms of ART. For PrEP, however, there are two things here. On the provider side, I think many providers, especially in the hospitals, are very used to the way we counseling adherence to ART clients, which actually is totally different for PrEP clients. We actually don't really have to concern that much about the exact timing of taking PrEP every day. It's just that if you can choose a good time for you, and so that you can, you would not forget to take it. But it's not like you have to take it. It should not be 5 minutes late or 10 minutes late. That's one thing, and you have to take it every day. That's true for ART, but for PrEP, especially among men who have sex with men, we know that there is higher level of forgiveness in terms of that. But so this is really hard for providers who are ART providers to really change their mindset into, now you are providing counseling for PrEP clients, not ART clients. And somehow, I think that affects the retention rate in PrEP program, because clients feel that if they don't follow what is recommended for PrEP adherence very strictly or carefully, they would not want to come back to the clinic, because they don't want to be like judged and then have to go through another big round of counseling, you know, which is not good, because we know that for HIV prevention, even though you decide to stop PrEP, because for PrEP you can stop and then you can restart, you can restart again. That's depending on the level of risk that you're having, right? People should feel comfortable come back for HIV testing, even though they are not taking PrEP. But what is happening right now is that they will just like turn away from the clinic because they are not being a good PrEP client. In the counselor's eyes. Yeah. So I think that that's something that we are facing, that we see not very good retention rate in PrEP program. And this, I mean, not only people continue to take PrEP, but people not coming back, even for HIV testing, right? So this is what we are working with in Thailand. I mean, working with the providers in Thailand to really get the new mindset set for PrEP counseling. However, among those who come back for PrEP visit, PrEP follow-up visit, adherence is perfect. And this is true both in demonstration projects where PrEP is free, and in service where PrEP is like fee-based PrEP program.